Hello, I'm Dr. Cicelina Ledbetter, Professor of Psychology in the Division of Social and Behavioral Sciences in the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia and your host for A Healthy Mind. The purpose of this television series is to educate and keep our community informed about mental health, from public policy and environmental factors to the various disorders that affect healthy minds. What are the building blocks of the psychological dynamics behind memorable films like A Beautiful Mind, Manchester by the Sea, Black Swan, or Moonlight? How were such complex psychological characters captured in a 90-minute movie, and what is inside the mind made present on the screen for our entertainment and, yes, education about mental processes? My guest, Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods, is a licensed clinical psychologist whose interest lies in the intersection of psychology and media. She consults with screenwriters, documentary filmmakers, media outlets, and authors to accurately integrate psychological aspects into plots and provide character analyses. Fun. She also has authored articles for Huffington Post and the former American Psychological Association's Psych Critiques. She continues to blog with Thrive Global and Medium. Dr. Marshall Woods is also a professor of psychology at the George Washington University, faculty with the Washington School of Psychiatry, and the Assistant Director of Psychology at the Psychiatric Institute of Washington. She has a private practice in Washington, D.C., where she works with individuals in psychotherapy and administers comprehensive psychological evaluations to persons of all ages. Dr. Marshall Woods joins me to discuss understanding how psychological dynamics are present in film and the media. Welcome, Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's so good to have you.
Thank you for having me.
I was so excited about talking to you about psychological thrillers because in my house, I do your job. So
great.
I just play, and so I'm like, no. If they were really, really trying to do the whole psychological thing, it would be this way, you guys, and they
yes.
believe me. They totally believe me. So, but tell me about how do you land a career in psychology and the media the way you have? This is like a dream job in my mind.
Maybe not a dream job for everyone.
Right.
Previously I had a background in the arts, as well as in television, behind the scenes, of course. Uh-huh. And my passion was always psychology. Mm-hmm. And so even when I was younger, I knew I would pursue my education in psychology and become a therapist, etc. But I could not shake the idea that when I would see psychology on film or within the media and television, that many times the accuracy of what was portrayed was not exactly what individuals would get from a therapist or even attending therapy. Wow. As a result, in our field and in our environments and community, there's so much stigma around receiving mental health.
Right.
And so, yielding my fascination and passion mm-hmm. with film and media, mm-hmm. I thought that psychology and film and media was a natural marriage for me.
So did you call up the movie producers and say, hey, that's wrong. This person is not supposed to be performing like this. How did you kind of break into that? Because I don't know. I mean, I talk to a lot of people. And I've never talked to anyone who is really, we've talked about the psychological implications of Hollywood and all of that. Mm-hmm. But really being able to, because you don't really think about the characters and how the character development and how important it is mm-hmm. to create an authentic character, right? It has to be deep. You have to have some depth. And it's only 90 minutes.
Right.
So how did you kind of break into that? It's kind of fascinating.
Sure. So previously, many individuals wanted me to come on TV shows like this.
Okay.
And to talk about psychology, talk about post-traumatic stress.
Okay.
I had worked in the Middle East, so okay. how is it working with active military personnel and things of sorts. So okay. I was able to meet really interesting people
within television.
Yet, when it came to writing and performing research, that was not necessary. necessarily my passion. And so someone came to me and said, what would you really want to write about? And I said, actually, psychology and film, because I felt that there was this huge discrepancy at times between what my patients would see on television, and they would say, the only experience I have with therapy is the time I've spent with you and what I see on television, and that is significantly different.
That makes a lot of sense.
And it would stop them from even calling. They said, I was so hesitant to come to therapy because of what I would see on television. And so I felt there was a need to have an accurate depiction of what therapy was, as well as even characters who are experiencing mental health issues or concerns, how they're navigating those situations, because ultimately, TV, whether it's reality TV or film, provides us a window into how people navigate situations and create alternative options for their lives.
That's right, and we don't often think about that, like the impact that, because you think about mental health and therapy and stigma, but what we don't think about is there's this tube in front of people, and what is the impact that this is having on even their choices around whether they get a therapist or not.
Absolutely.
Who thinks about that?
Absolutely.
So I think that that's really, that's pretty noble, the kind of work that you're doing, even though you're like, oh, wow, it's kind of, I think that is quite fascinating.
Thank you.
So when you kind of talked about you'd seen images in Hollywood, in New York, you know, the two centers, what movie did you see early on that kind of, you were just like, this is wrong on so many levels?
Goodness.
Right? Or can you think of a movie or a show that just seemed to be off?
I remember watching the film Identity, which was, I'm dating myself quite far ago.
You don't have to say the date.
Okay, great.
Since you know,
I'm sure someone will Google when it actually occurred.
Right.
And I remember how fascinated I was by the concept of the film. And at that time, I was not a clinical psychologist. I was actually in school to become a clinical psychologist, which also dates me. The film is about this man who is incarcerated, and he is experiencing symptoms of dissociative identity disorder. So he has many personalities, and the therapist who works with him is attempting to gain him an opportunity to not remain incarcerated, to receive therapeutic services, or even, I'm not sure, maybe even get off death row.
I see.
And the film was fascinating and very entertaining.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, is everyone who's watching this, are they aware of what they're watching here? They're watching this man go through a therapeutic moment of how to navigate and how to, at that time, kind of cure his DID symptoms. Does everyone even understand what this person's life's experience is? The fact that he has so many ego states inside of him.
Right.
Or is this just a purely a movie of entertainment?
Right.
And I realized the brevity of such a film and how, if this was mental health, something that was very much of an education for the public, they would understand, wow, I'm watching a movie about DID rather than it's just very entertaining.
Right, which is often what we think, right? We just go straight to, oh, this is just Hollywood. This is entertainment.
Exactly.
This doesn't really exist. Or maybe it does, but I don't really know what to do with it. I don't know where to put it.
Exactly.
And so there could be some danger in that, right? Just kind of putting that out there and not kind of nurturing it and, you know, making sure it has a soft landing.
Exactly. And in particular with this film, what I found also interesting is that the individual who had the symptoms of DID was incarcerated, and he was considered extremely dangerous. And I felt, here is an opportunity to think about DID, even provide some education about DID, but the connotation is this person is scary and or a criminal or dangerous, and the implication that would have to the public.
So was that one of your first, is that the one that it resonates as one that really kind of got you thinking about this field and the work?
It was,
absolutely. Okay. So let's think about like some of the modern day ones that you have had just loads of fun, I'm projecting, working on. And I think that, well, let's start at the top. Okay. Get Out.
Okay.
Let's talk about Get Out.
Very popular.
Very popular movie. Mm-hmm. I didn't quite think of it as a psychological thriller, but I had to see it twice, so I could. I'm going to hold the possibility that it is. Mm-hmm. I remember Jordan Peele.
Yes.
Jordan Peele, he was offended because it also got rated as a comedy. It was kind of a highly textured.
It's certainly highly textured.
Presentation.
Yes.
So what about Get Out? Where did you sort of insert influence in that movie?
Sure. When I think about Get Out, I think about two major factors that I feel stand out in particular. One is that there is an individual, the young man who's playing a boyfriend of this young lady who brings him to the family home, and in that is will be holding him captive, and actually taking his body over, and will hold him in bondage for the remainder of his days if he goes through this irreversible surgery. And not to give too much away for people who haven't
seen it. That's their fault. Go ahead, give it away.
So there are two ideas. Is that what is slavery at this point, and what is bondage, and how do people navigate a fight for freedom? Mm. So that is a historical, psychological, distressing situation that people experience. Even to this day, there's still modern slavery.
Right.
So how do people really navigate that stressor, and what does modern slavery even look like? Because it isn't with chains and being sold off on auction blocks, even though that was nicely described and illustrated within Get Out, a silent auction for his
That's
life.
That's right. So
there's this one part that's based in history.
Right.
And how do we navigate trying to save ourselves from being, again, enslaved?
Yeah.
And on the other hand, there is an opportunity to look at the film and think about relationships, specifically intimate ones in itself. And what about our current relationships? Do we think that our partners are always honest with us? Mm. It's almost tell us little lies, because that is how she was able to woo him to the family home, is through gentle manipulations of sexual innuendos and actually intercourse and a romantic relationship.
Right.
And so do we really think that our partners are always honest with us?
Right.
And so thinking about the research that goes on that, that's something where people can say, well, if I've watched Get Out and I never think about myself in a situation where I would ever be enslaved, or I would never get myself into that situation, the question I would then pose to them is, how susceptible do you believe you are to deception?
Right. And oftentimes you can't really answer that, because if you it's sort of an oxymoron. You can't always know whether you're being deceived, because if you knew it, then you might not be deceived.
Deceived, exactly.
So I think that's quite an interesting take. Where, how is your craft inserted into that? What, how do you function in that? So do they call you, because you said most of the work that you do is by phone, and ask, how is this presented? How exactly do you work in that space?
Sure. So Get Out, I did not work on.
Okay,
but
yeah.
Yes, but And what happens is that individuals will call me and say, I have a concept or an idea regarding a film or
at
movie.
At the treatment stage?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
And I have these characters, and these are the preliminary scripts that we have. And we want to know whether or not this individual, let's say for character analyses, would actually behave in this way. Mm-hmm. We want this person to portray someone who is depressed, but only depressed because they have persistent bereavement disorder, or they are depressed and have persistent depression disorder, not clinical depression 100%. So how would that look different?
Okay.
And what sort of symptoms would they portray? And so I can help develop that character with them. Or they will say, well, we have these two characters who we know will be going to couples therapy. How will the psychologist present in the room? How will they sit? How will they talk
really,
to the individual?
That level of detail.
Yes. Even with set accuracy, where should we put the table? Should we put a cup here? What kind of cup? Will that matter? Does the therapist need to be closer to the door or not? Would mm-hmm. they actually walk them out? Would right. they answer the door?
Right. And things, everything matters.
Everything matters.
Right? Everything matters.
Yes, because in therapy, when we're providing these services to a patient, those things matter.
They do.
And so it would make sense that they would equally matter if they were on film.
Yeah, because and as you say that, I'm thinking about, and I'm sort of going backwards, reverting back to that the slave auction. It almost seems like there's this threshold of reality. But I don't really know if it's a real threshold of reality. So could that really happen? Do you know what I mean? Like, could it really happen mm-hmm. that you could be go away with your significant other and be caught up in this whole modern day slave thing? Where they, what his brother said, I told you you're going to be a sex slave. I told you not to get in that car. Right?
Yes.
So is it really possible that something like that can happen? It's kind of mind blowing.
Yes, it is. And it's interesting, but again, this idea of the power of deception.
Yeah.
And whether it's placing someone in bondage or even placing them in an uncompromising situation that isn't, let's say, being enslaved, how susceptible can someone be, and what then are the consequences of that?
Right.
I mean, for modern day slavery, let's say individuals who are sold into work forces,
right.
Where they have
like
not
the trafficking?
Exactly,
yes.
for trafficking okay. or working under terms that they have not agreed with,
right.
or the terms are not exactly what they thought,
mm-hmm.
again, deceived in the notion. And so even though maybe individuals wouldn't say, well, I would not put myself in a situation where I would be, you know, be victim or mm-hmm. become victim mm-hmm. of a neurosurgical procedure
yeah,
and take
yeah.
my life away. But there are individuals who can and who have been very vulnerable in vulnerable times in their lives where deception and the desire to get ahead and
yeah.
to actually survive places them in uncompromising situations
yeah.
In modern slavery.
And it almost feels like until you, because I have to admit, sometimes I do watch 2020, right? So, but until you see these stories where you're like, really, you got mm-hmm. captive and you were gone for 10 years and you were living with this person and you had children, and what do? We go, oh, like you know, people who have not lived that experience, we go, there's no way,
mm-hmm.
I could. But the truth is, and I asked you this earlier, is it art imitating life? Or is it life imitating art in
mm-hmm.
a lot of the work that you do?
Sure.
There may be some sort of a delicate dance.
I would definitely say absolutely.
Yeah.
Art imitates life,
yeah.
and we imitate the art of what we see.
That's right.
And so if that is the case, I cannot imagine why we wouldn't necessarily have attention
yeah.
to the implications that art has upon our lives. Because we watch art, and you know, some people question whether you know reality TV is that really art, but it is an art form.
It is.
And so if we know that we're watching individuals in a conflictual moment and then they forgive one another and they are able to move on with their friendships and then they have another conflict and
right,
that's the
right.
cycle
this
of
the
right that's the
reality
cycle.
TV.
Exactly. But for individuals who struggle with forgiveness, reality TV can be a very helpful platform to be able to say, oh, well, I never thought about taking this person's side on this, or being able to be empathetic and put my feet in their shoes when it comes to that. And maybe I do need to work on forgiveness. And why is it so challenging for me to forgive?
Right.
And so it gives people another option to be able to heal.
That's interesting. A positive aspect of reality TV. Unbelievable. You just turn that around, because I wouldn't have, yeah. But that is interesting, because they do kind of go for it.
Sure.
And then the next episode, they're like, oh, well, mm-hmm. that's my boo. And it's like, what?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
But, you know, we're called to do that. Those of us that are. Right? So let's move on to another movie. What's your, what
sure.
are you, what is your favorite right now. So oh, you talked about Hacksaw Ridge.
I did.
You really like that movie.
I did.
So lay the plot real quickly about Hacksaw Ridge.
A very short plot. There is an individual who is young and optimistic, and he is a conscientious objector in the military. So he's unable, based upon his beliefs, to touch a gun. And everyone around him is attempting to get him to train with weaponry. And they bully him even into doing it. They physically assault him. They note that he's not going to save everyone's life. Right. And he really is joining the military in order to be a medic. And so he doesn't want to take life. He wants to use his opportunity to save life. Mm-hmm. And really, that movie touches upon the idea of how hard is it to keep your convictions in the face of adversity, as well as in the face of letting people down who you're signing up and really want to be there for.
Right. And I think the interesting piece is that being able to, because I think part of the movie, he was able to kind of get the trust. He was able to get the trust of the team, the guys, the unit, right? And eventually he ended up doing that which they said he could not do.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
And so part of that is, if in standing in your convictions, I think as when you talk about negotiating peer pressure and how important that is, is that movies like that really show that, if, you know, even though you stand alone, because clearly he was out on his own.
He was on his own.
Yeah.
And actually risking to be incarcerated throughout the duration of the war. Yeah. And what does that mean for someone? And this is based on a true story.
Yeah.
And so how does one navigate wanting to be a savior and a rescuer of individuals and a healer of individuals, but those same individuals are not on your side to
That's hard. And that's where trust in relationships sort of comes. And I think, I don't remember which brand of the military, but it doesn't matter because they all have the same thing. They really foster unity and brotherhood or sisterhood. Yes. And, you know, we all go down together. We stand together.
Exactly.
But I think that, you know, that just the way it ended with him really being the hero, I thought was quite fascinating. And I think our young people can learn a lot.
Yes.
From being able to stand on their own convictions, despite the fact, despite what things look like, and it also with bullying and all of the stuff that we're seeing in the media now,
exactly.
the narrative around bullying, the narrative around violence,
yes.
that being able to see something where someone is really standing in a very violent space.
Exactly.
And choosing nonviolence.
And choosing nonviolence. And also being secure within yourself, which is very difficult for young individuals. It's hard because they're questioning, who are they really? And that's actually normal developmentally, is that going through young teenage years all the way into emerging adulthood, you're questioning, who are you? What are your convictions? What are your beliefs? And what should I stand by?
Right.
And your friends become a very integral part in understanding who you are.
They do.
So to have such conviction, even despite your peers at that time in your life, is pretty remarkable.
It is, and remarkable, rare.
Rare, yes.
Right? Really rare. And I think, you know, that, that it kind of bore itself out. So we have like 4 minutes, but I want to get another one in. I'm going to try really hard. So Moonlight, is that too big?
That's too big.
Okay.
Yes.
That's too big. Yeah.
Yes.
Because, okay, so, but let's do it anyway.
Okay.
Let's do it anyway.
Okay.
We're going to do like the Cliff Notes version.
The Cliff Notes, Moonlight. There are three main characters, a young boy who's trying to learn his identity and try to navigate his world with a parent who is absent because of substance use and a man who is a illegal substance dealer who takes him in and fathers him. And there are three main, I think, psychological aspects of this movie is how to navigate trauma, which for him, his life was traumatic because of neglect. How this man who is taking him in is loved and could be hated. He's an illegal substance seller in the community, and he's selling to his mother.
Right.
Yet there's a part of us that still love this character because he's taking care of this boy.
They exist. those paradoxes exist.
Yes, right? These paradoxes exist. People are not just unidimensional. And then you have a mother who loves her child, but of course is compromised because of substances in the attempt to try and gain back his love. And once that happens, how that actually allows his identity to flourish.
Right, right. And you know what the other piece is that, I told you that every time I tried to watch that movie, my husband was like, I don't want to watch that movie. Why didn't And then that is what happens when the characters jump out of the screen.
Yes, absolutely. The characters at time can impact the audience so significantly that it's difficult to watch.
Yes.
Especially if an individual, I'm not sure of African-American descent, sure, for an example, a male watching this, if they can see parts of themselves, yes, within the caregiving male, yep, or the young boy, yeah, going through all of the challenges,
yeah,
or even a woman who is experiencing substance use and they have,
that's
a
right,
child, if they can align with that character, sometimes it's very difficult to be able to watch the films that we see.
I think so. I mean, and there are even movies that I get like completely jumped on every time they are. You didn't see that? I didn't see Birth of a Nation. Because I got to one, I don't know how many minutes there was this one scene and I shut it off and I never turned it back on. It was,
yes,
it was just too much.
Yes.
I'm like, I'm supposed to be able to do this. What's going on here? I should be able to watch this, but
right,
I could not get through it.
But see, this is the beauty of film and psychology. We don't have the opportunity to turn off our lives when it gets too much, generally.
That's right.
Usually, we have to endure and figure out ways to cope.
That's right.
But when we see on television something that is similar or something that is just as emotionally triggering,
yeah,
we can have the power and control to turn the television off. We can turn it to something else, so then we watch a comedy and laugh.
That's right.
And use a different defense of humor, which is a lot more comfortable for most people.
That's right.
Or we could just say, you know what, I'm gonna pause this and watch this when I'm at a better place emotionally.
That's right.
So we have more power and control then of our emotional status when,
yeah,
we're watching it on film.
That's
rather
right,
than what if we're going through it in real life.
That's true. And it could, you know, I suppose it could build resilience if you decided that you were going to use it, because there are studies that show that if you practice something, including the like emotional fortitude, you know, mental games that you can play with yourself, mm-hmm, that if you practice that even in your mind, that you become more resilient.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes,
I think that's what film can do for us.
It can. It's,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much. This has been like,
yes,
it's great. If you'd like more information about Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods, you can contact her at psychmindedmedia@gmail.com. If you'd like to aspire, accomplish, and take on the world in the field of behavioral sciences, consider pursuing a degree in the field of social or behavioral sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. You can learn more about the psychology program by visiting the university's website at www.udc.edu. I'm Dr. Cicelina Grosser Ledbetter. If you'd like to reach me, visit me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Dr. Cis. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time on A Healthy Mind.